Hey everyone, it's me, Wendy. As some of you may know, I recently made my own wedding dress and I finally have this video ready so I can show you how the whole thing went. My fabric came from an online store called Fabric Wholesale Direct. There is a link in the description with more details there for you. They do have a really wide array of bridal friendly fabrics and it's pretty reasonable prices, so if this is something you're interested in, you can check it out. There is also in the description a blog post that I wrote with a lot more of the written out detailed measurements that I used. If you're watching this because you also want to make your own wedding dress, that blog post will definitely be really helpful to you. This whole thing was exhausting. Like, it really tested my patience, my willpower, and the ability to stick to a plan, your own plan, even though a lot of other people can have different opinions. Of course, everyone's idea of an ideal wedding dress is totally different, and yeah, it's hard to go so deep down a road towards your own and ignore all the other options out there. Feel free to sip some tea while you read it. I'm just kidding, it's not that bad. But I tried to be honest because when I was gonna make my own wedding dress, I did a ton of research to prepare myself for what to expect. And likewise, if you're here for that purpose too, I wanna be honest because I think it will be helpful for you to summon your strength. I'll get right into the tutorial and obviously at the end, I'll show you how it all looked on my wedding day. There were four types of layers that went into this skirt. The first two dealt with solid lining fabric. This fabric helped go on the inside to make the skirt really comfortable. And then there was one more layer that added color and richness to the skirt. The second two layers deal with netting. On the inside of the skirt, there was a layer of crinoline, which is a type of netting. It built up the shape of the skirt. And on the outside, there was tulle, which is a netting that can be used to be light and fluffy and magical, all the things you want out of a fluffy tulle skirt. Starting from the inside and building to the outside, I had 6 meters of this rich red lining fabric, and we're going to use that to make two complete circle skirts. Here's an example of the two pieces that make up one circle skirt. It's hard to show the full thing because I can't zoom out enough on my camera, but here's how they look folded up, and as I unfold them, it completely goes into one half of a circle. So if I sew these two halves together, it'll be a full circle skirt. Before we do that though, one of the semicircles needs to be cut in half right down the middle, and that's gonna form the back seam of the skirt. You don't want a seam to end up in the front of the skirt, so you have two seams on your two hips and one seam in the back, which is the one we're cutting right open. Now we can sew together the circle skirt starting from the two seams that go down the hips. Here's how it looks with the two hip seams done up. The last one is the one in the back middle, and for that one we're only going to go part way up so we can leave room for the zipper. You can go ahead and make the exact same thing one more time, and now we're going to work on the crinoline layer. I made another circle skirt that was just 30 centimeters tall this time and did the same thing where I sewed up all the sides except for the back for the zipper. Here's the strips of crinoline I cut. If you want to know the exact dimensions of every single one, don't forget there is a link in the description for you because there are a lot of numbers, so I just wanted to write it out. We're going to gather every strip of crinoline along the top edge, and the way I do that is I put on the widest stitch length, sew a straight stitch all the way across, then go back to the beginning and add one more straight stitch so that they're running totally parallel. If you watch a lot of my videos, you've seen me do this gathering technique a lot of times, so I'm going to go over it pretty quickly. Once that's done to every piece of crinoline, you'll go to one end of it, separate the top two threads from the bottom two threads, and then we're going to tie the top two threads together. On the other end, we're going to separate the top two threads from the bottom threads and tie together the two bottom threads. This helps to secure the threads so they don't slip out by accident. When you grab the two threads that are not tied together and start pulling along the fabric, the whole thing will gather. With every layer of crinoline, I pinned them right sides together and then pushed along the gathers so that they were evened out and added pins along the way. We're going to sew every strip of crinoline together so that in the end, you have a skirt that gradually gets wider and wider. The more dramatic you make the differences in width for every layer of crinoline, the more your skirt's gonna flare out. Once I had every layer of crinoline down, I folded the skirt right sides together and sewed all the way down the center back along the crinoline. I left that top open once again so that there would be room for the zipper. I stacked the skirt so that there was lining on the inside for comfort, crinoline for shape, and then one more lining just to separate the crinoline from the tulle, because the crinoline is not as pretty as the lining. We're gonna go ahead and add the invisible zipper, and I do this by laying down the zipper turning each of the straps outwards and pinning it in place. Make sure you use the zipper foot on your sewing machine to get as close as possible to the teeth of the zipper. The link in my description does have a link to a really detailed invisible zipper tutorial if you're not as experienced with invisible zippers. And tulle! This will be the final top layer of the skirt, but really it's lots of layers because you can add as many layers of tulle as you want. Just like with the lining, I cut out a ton of semicircles with this tulle. So many semicircles. All of them get sewn together to make a full circle, and you put on some music or a podcast, line up the straight edges of the tulle, sew all the way down, and do this forever. Honestly, even cutting every single layer of this tulle was so exhausting, so just prepare yourself. If you make it the exact same circle skirt dimensions as your lining, your skirt is going to probably look a lot more A-line than the bell shape. So if you really want your skirt to puff out for the bell shape, be a little bit generous on the width of the top opening of the tulle, because that way when you put it on, you'll get to gather it a little, and that gathering will help puff it out to be more of a bell instead of an A shape. Taking that base of the skirt that we made, we're gonna stack every single layer of tulle over it. Try to go one by one because it might save your sanity a little. These sewing clips came in really handy for this part. I lined up the seams on the two hips every single time and then opened up the clip to bring in every new layer of tulle. Once every layer of tulle is attached, you can go ahead and do a straight stitch all the way around. This part involves a lot of hugging fabric and heaving it here and there. Make sure you take your time, don't get too impatient with it. When I'm sewing the tulle, I reached in to the skirt every single time to make sure every single layer of tulle was lined up and going to get caught underneath the sewing machine. As you make your way around, some of the tulle may slip here and there. You want to make sure you grab it, bring it all under the needle, and get it all locked in place. The final step with the tulle is to look at the area where the zipper is in the back. You're going to reach into the tulle and gently cut it open using a pair of scissors, just one straight slit, and you only need it to go as deep as the zipper. This helps to make sure you can actually get in and out of the skirt, and I know it sounds a bit scary to cut the tulle, but when it's all zipped up, the layers of the tulle and richness really hide this whole cut away. This is an example of how it looks with five layers of tulle. On my white skirt, I did add quite a few more. I think it's roughly more like 10 layers. And to make it extra nice, I added one layer of super fine tulle as the topmost layer, because that is the part that you feel. It's also the part that kind of keeps away bugs and hair and branches and grass. And so if you can afford some more fine tulle, I really advise that going on the outermost layer to finish it off and make it look really nice. The bottom of the skirt may also need to be hemmed or trimmed, depending on how the height turned out. Try to save that for when you're sure what shoes you're going to wear with the skirt. You will have to trim every single layer if they need trimming, and then only the lining layers need hemming because the tulle netting doesn't really unravel. For the top, I wanted to use a nice, rich piece of satin. I had 2 meters of this fabric, and it was more than enough to make a princess seam halter top. The top half of dresses is especially challenging to fit if you're not experienced with drafting your own patterns. I really, really advise just copying a pattern that's pre-made from a booklet. But here's the pieces I needed for my princess seam. It's one to go in the top middle. I need 2 of this one next to it for the sides, and then 2 of this other one to go in the back. If you want to change the neckline, you can make it more V-shaped or scoop, but I stuck with having just a little bit of a curve. When all these pieces are sewn right sides together along the seams, here is what you get. The bottom should be completely straight to go all the way around your waist. You've got these 2 bumps in the front, which should fit around your chest, and then the 2 seams on the side to go straight down your sides. With satin, it's so important to use fresh needles and a narrow stitch. This one was done as a rough draft, so you can see the way the satin really shows all the flaws. It shows all the stitches that are too wide. It shows all the puckering that happens at the areas where it didn't fit quite right. And that was something where after I was done this draft piece, I realized this type of satin was probably not going to cut it for me. It's extremely unforgiving, way too soft. It'll show every single bump. I didn't even know if I could get away wearing my strapless bra without anything showing. So in the end, when I made my white dress, I did switch over to a much stiffer satin. And I really recommend this if you're new to working with satin too. Go with the stiff stuff. It's so much more forgiving. It holds its own shape. You don't have to worry so much about building the infrastructure on the inside. It is a nice and firm satin that can just look rich and luxurious standing on its own. You're going to want to repeat all of this so that you have 2 complete layers in total. One layer is going to go on the inside touching you, and one layer is going to go on the outside for everyone else to see. When you have your two complete layers, you sew them with a straight stitch up the side, across the top, and back down the other side so that if it's flipped right side outwards, you're going to be able to see the nice and finished satin. To get the straps into the top before you finish it off, just make sure they're touching the right side at those two top peaks before you secure your two layers together. When you flip it, the two straps will be coming out the top of the skirt. I attached the skirt to the top using one straight stitch all the way around, and then on the back, just above the zipper, I did add one of those hook eye closures and two little loops of strap. Once I had the skirt on, I just had to bring the two straps over my shoulders and have someone help tie them to those loops in the back to secure it. Because this was my own wedding dress, I did take the extra care to add a nice waistband on the inside, just because the raw edges might have chafed against my skin a bit, and the soft waistband is a nice little treat. I think through making my own wedding dress, I appreciate so much more the work that goes into existing wedding dresses, and I understand a bit better the price tags that are associated with them. Mine was a ton of work, and on the spectrum of wedding dresses, I even know it's deeper down the simpler end of things. So if you want beads, sequins, lace, some parts see-through, some parts not see-through, you know, all of those things really add to the complexity of the dress. If I had to pick a hardest part of the entire project, it would have been the princess seams. I had a couple of attempts to do it, and it was just not working out quite right, but I was really losing determination because the day was getting closer, and I was like, I'm sure it's good enough, we'll make do. But if it were not for my mom showing up, being a fairy godmother of the whole situation, it would not have been the same. She had the patience to undo the stitching, adjust it, re-sew it. I think she did it at least 5 times, and that's for every single seam, and then twice because it's inside and outside. It was something I don't even know how to thank her properly for, and in the end, it looked so much better than when it started. When I got compliments the day of that my dress looked great, I just had to give credit to my mom every time. If it were not for her, we might not have made it to the finish line that way. I'll wrap this up by showing you how it looked on the day of. If you don't want to miss any of my future videos, don't forget to hit the red button, subscribe, and also follow me on Instagram. If you want to see more photos, it is at Withwendy. Thank you so much to everyone who wrote messages and comments full of encouragement. Dan and I really felt the love. And then on top of that, we reached 500,000 subscribers before the wedding. So we were like over the moon. We were so excited. We are happy to be able to share this with you. Enjoy.